Welcome to Yung Tuition. Let's continue discussing basic issues in atmospheric physics in relation to climate research that you may or may not know, but would be delighted by watching this short talk. Today's talk is a special, which is about my latest paper published a few weeks ago. In short, I have formulated the outgoing longwave radiation, OLR, based on my new idea that the surface infrared radiation might be zero. As this new idea seems unthinkable for many people, I would not be surprised this talk would make many climate researchers shudder at thought or sleepless. Are you ready? Let's go and have fun. The imaginary greenhouse effect was originally used to reduce the radiation cooling at the surface of the Earth, which emits infrared ray at 390 watt per meter square at 288 Kelvin. As described in many textbooks. But what if I tell you there is no surface infrared radiation at all in the presence of the atmosphere? What would you react? The end of the world? So far, the outgoing infrared radiation, known as OLR for all climate researchers, has been formulated as the sum of the transmitted surface infrared radiation and the upward infrared radiation by the atmosphere at the top of the atmosphere. In doing so, however, an important fact was ignored, as I discussed before, namely the surface and the immediate air layers are in thermal equilibrium as far as their temperatures are concerned. Once we take this fact into account, there should be no heat transfer at the surface, including the infrared radiation. One can call this as a real blanket effect, the blanket made by air molecules, 99% by nitrogen and oxygen gases. Based on this corollary of thermodynamics law, I have proposed this formula for the outgoing infrared radiation, which is completely irradiated by the atmosphere. Wait a moment, someone might yell, without an infrared source, how can the infrared absorber absorb in the first place? Well, that is made by thermal excitation, by frequently molecular collisions in the atmosphere, including nitrogen and oxygen molecules, which are driven by convection and advection to circulate in almost everywhere in the troposphere. Here, epsilon is the effective air emissivity, rho is the air density, and T sub A is the atmospheric temperature at different altitudes. Because the air density and the vertical atmospheric temperature can be directly measured, therefore, the air emissivity and OLR can be determined at the same time. Compared with the commonly used formula for OLR derived from the Schwarzschild equation and Kirchhoff's law, the first term for the transmitted surface radiation disappears. Furthermore, without invoking any weighting functions for gas distributions, the universal air density distribution is used to scale the effective air emissivity so that it will quickly approach to zero as the altitudes are higher than the tropopause. In essence, it is argued that once the surface temperature reaches to 288 Kelvin, the solar shortwave radiation absorbed by the surface would be completely transferred into the atmosphere. Meanwhile, the solar shortwave radiation absorbed by the atmosphere also increases the internal energy of the atmosphere. In this way, the atmospherical thermal temperature distribution will be formed with a distinct lapse rate in the troposphere. It is inside such a thermal source, infrared absorbers, predominantly water molecules, would absorb and emit according to basic laws in thermodynamics. The higher the altitudes, the easier the thermal radiation by the atmosphere can reach to the outer space. In fact, the simplest scenario would be that all of the shortwave radiation from the sun is completely re-emitted by the atmosphere in the space. In effect, our planet acts as a perfect optical reflector whenever the ground temperature reaches to a constant. This paradigm shift is due to recent distinguishing the subtle difference between infrared absorbers in a pipe, as John Tyndall used in 1860, not 1960, as I said in my previous video, and the infrared absorption in the real atmosphere. One regular viewer commented on my video on May 28th, the temperature gradient must exist in that gas pipe. Indeed, if the gap between the gas and the source is removed, and an extremely cold source is placed at the cold end, then that would be a ha-ha or eureka moment. To my surprise, several linear relations among the variables in this formula have been revealed, including the dependence of the outgoing infrared radiation on the surface temperature TS. That is a big issue, because since the 1950s, climate researchers have been puzzled by the relation between OLR and the surface temperature. For example, Manabe and Westworld obtained this figure from their climate model in 1967. The slope is 2.36. They speculated this might be caused by the emission heights of the OLR in the atmosphere without any quantitative formula. More recently, in 2018, Cole and Cronin wrote that the linear relation between OLR and the surface temperature is a fundamental yet poorly understood feature of Earth's climate, and suggested it was due to water feedback. The slope they used is 2.2, which has immediately become a kind of the gold standard for calculating the climate sensitivity. In 2021, the same team reported that some loops can be identified in different sections of such a linear curve as shown in this figure. They were puzzled that the single-valued linear function previously thought might be multi-value function of the local surface temperature and other variables. Based on their radiative transfer calculations, they shown that in the tropics, OLR loops could be caused by seasonal variations in relative humidity that are out of phase with the surface temperature. While in the actual tropics, OLR loops are mainly due to variations in lapse rates. Nevertheless, no analytical formula could be found. Now it's my turn. Without invoking the greenhouse effect, these theoretical difficulties disappear once my simple formula for OLR is applied. To be specific, the relation between two variables can be numerically derived by keeping other variables fixed. In particular, it is revealed that both the relation between OLR and the surface temperature and that between OLR and the lapse rate are linear, as shown in this simple equation. Notice the slope in this equation is 3.2 instead of 2.2 for the dependence on the surface temperature when the tropospherical lapse rate is fixed. To visualize this three-variable function, namely OLR, surface temperature in K, and the lapse rate in K per kilometer, I will use a CADMO again. As you can see, a wide range of constant OLR values can be achieved and maintained by changing the surface temperature and the lapse rate at the same time. But it would appear the value 239 watt per meter square for OLR is special or unique for this planet. On the other hand, different pairs of the surface temperature and the lapse rate in the troposphere can be used to achieve that special OLR value. Although the pair 288 Kelvin and 6.5 K per kilometer seems the natural selection of the Earth. Of course, this is equivalent to say, I don't know why. Indeed, many natural phenomena remain unexplained, such as why the sun's temperature has been so stable. Nevertheless, I realized that a loop can be formed if the oscillations of the lapse rate and the surface temperature are 90 degrees out of phase, as shown in this diagram, which has nothing to do with any greenhouse effect such as water feedback. Furthermore, given the OLR equal to the current equilibrium value, 239 watt per meter square, another linear equation between the surface temperature and the lapse rate is numerically obtained. This could be another equation of paramount importance. Why? Because it implies that OLR will be the same if the surface temperature and the lapse rate change in accordance with this new linear equation. I will discuss this soon in relation to the 1967 paper by Manabe and Worthwood. It would be fun too. Well, this talk is longer than others, but there are many related basic issues to be discussed or reconsidered. So please stay tuned. Thank you for your viewing. See you next time.